Okay. I was like, what meeting am I in? All right. Guys. Okay. We are recording. All right. So I'm going to jump in and people can join whenever, just because we've got a lot to talk about today. Make sure we're recording. Good, good, good. Okay. So I've got some people here. We're having this really awesome discussion here about, dogs and humans and how the parallels are. So today, what I wanted to do is give you guys an intro to the middle. I would say it's kind of the middle of our new Quantum Metamorphosis Academy, basically it's the treasure hunt. It's all of the clues that we have been given over our eternity on how to actually embody the God consciousness here and now in this lifetime without us having to die and come back and do this again. Like, how do we actually walk in our God consciousness in body? Okay, so that's what the Quantum Metamorphosis Academy is going to be. And it's probably going to take a few more months because we're putting all these big pieces together. We've got the Imagineering. And once you kind of like remember, rewire who you truly are from that higher place, and you start operating in adrenalized joy and bliss, your body starts to activate superhuman DNA within you that is going to be your new addiction, hopefully, so that the 3D world stops being so addictive. Right now, your body is addicted to the programs in your subconscious mind, and that's why it feels like a power struggle. Your body is a very addictive species, and it focuses and obsesses on that which it desires. Because when you have something, you very rarely focus and obsess over it. You only focus and obsess over the lack of manifesting. That is one of your manifesting tools, guys. It's not a bad thing to be super hyper self obsessed. I would highly recommend that you become the center of your universe, and whatever guilt and shame pops up, you deal with it. Because without you being the conductor, the center, then you are not actually the leading role in your reality. And that means you're hot spotting or tailgating off of someone else's storyline that you prefer more. And it could be through avoidance of what is. So ultimately, the player, remember, guys, the player creates the playmates. The playmates then create the playground. So it's who is in your life and how is your life laid out is coming from the seed. So let's look at the seed as the unconscious. And what is growing out of the unconscious is the subconscious. The subconscious is what's growing out of the unconscious. And so if you, it, and one of our embodiment, do not let me forget this, please, one of you be my assistant today. I have two embodiment projects that will help your masculine energy visualize this, because where I'm going to take you today is through the principles of the thought rehab program. So I know there's a lot of mindset coach teachers out there and self-concept teachers and law of assumption teachers out there that are teaching mind diets. And I have even said, hey guys, we need to do a mind diet. And the deeper I get into my mentorships this year and with myself, we need full-blown rehab. The diet angle work. We're 600-pound life here. We need the operation, okay? And we it's I'm not saying we can't do this on our own, but your reality is so intoxicating to react and respond. Sometimes you are physically allergic to 3D. And when you become physically allergic to 3D, everything becomes sensitivity. So people who have like that sensitivity to socialness, like my social battery and anxiety around groups, that's a full-blown allergy, guys. You're just having a mental allergy. So if you're finding that you're not able to control your mind throughout the day, you're not able to be present and look at every single thing that is growing as what is actually in my subconscious and unconscious, then you might need to go through rehab, which I would recommend every human, because I will tell you that every single cell in your body wants subconscious programming to run. So you're up against, it feels like you're up against the matrix outside of you. You're not. You're actually up against your own body. And so, like I have explained before, is the inner child is caught in the middle of these two parenting tactics. The program is the ego, and it wants to parent the way that it wants to parent, because it is mortal. It is fear of death. It is afraid of loss. It is afraid of judgment. It is afraid of looking wrong. It is afraid of all the things that you were basically groomed into becoming in your first 7 years. And then you have this version of you that's never left heaven, that is all it, that it, that remains in a state of complete joy, bliss, and satisfaction. It has every need filled. And so when we start working in the Imagineering, what we're doing is we're learning to disciple off of that part of you. Disciple through discipline off of that higher level of consciousness that you truly are. You have that parent available, okay? But we're also taught to believe that we never get to see that parent unless we go into meditation, or we never get to like spend time with that parent because, you know, we're weird, or they're black sheep when we think this way, or we're delusional, right? But the thing is ultimately there has to be a choice between the old way of thinking and the comfortable way of the hope drug that turns into anticipation and then, you know, desire and then basically loss of acceptance, despair, disappointment, and then ultimately depressed. And then you get the amnesia again, you wait 3 months and you start all over. Okay. And you literally manifest the same person over again, the same situation over again, and the same reality, because you're literally growing from the root, aren't you? So if we're going to do thought rehab, it's not a mental diet of the throat chakra, which is my truth. Like, I can't start affirming up here because that's going to create all hell to break loose, as we've seen within our own affirmations. God forbid you do a sleep tape, you wake up with raging nightmares. Okay. So you realize is that the conflict needs to be dealt with at the root, and the change of power, the authority of who has custody over this inner child should be your entire focus right now. Okay. Because it is literally like going to court for your child, and you have to go up against all of your programming. And if you've ever gone up against a narcissist, you realize they use your weaknesses to make you look crazy. All right. It's like, as soon as you actually step into your power with a narcissist, you realize how powerless you are. Okay. Because they are one step ahead of you because they lack empathy for you. All right. Just like your ego lacks empathy for you. Now your higher consciousness has full empathy for you. Which parent do you want? The comfortable jail cell, the slavery program where it will always be 10 steps forward, 10 steps back. And I will tell you, every billionaire you see out there that's living in the matrix has had to exchange their soul, exchange their health, exchange their morals for what? Cash that they can't take with them? Okay. And the reason why they set up trusts for their family bloodline is because they know they're coming back. They're going to reincarnate right back in, and they're setting themselves up for how long their bodies can last, how many heart transplants they can afford before their body finally doesn't exist, and then they come back in the bloodline. They do enough psychic work to come back through that bloodline. You're not that smart. You're smarter in the higher realms, guys. You can't manipulate like that. You're not born for it. You're connected more to the consciousness of the heaven within you. You've always wanted peace in your family. You've always chose kindness, ultimately. Right? When you got back to yourself, you always chose kindness over being right. A lot of you. You wouldn't be in my class if you were choosing wrong. You'd be somewhere else, right? You'd be getting through 27 steps of Illuminati training right now. Okay? You're not here. And therefore, you have always desired peace, world peace, feeding the hungry, loving the sick, taking care of everybody, because the part of you that is here has done enough work on your soul to remember that part of you. This is the final leg of your journey, which means that now you have to go down into the root consciousness, which is unconscious, and you have to make it conscious. So to me, that's rehab. Because if you've ever had an addiction, which if you tell me you didn't, you're lying. If you've ever had addiction that consumed you and you couldn't stop doing it, and it shamed you, right? What finally made you change it? A bigger issue that you had to focus on? Because usually what will stop an addiction is a bigger problem to become addicted by, right? Oh, I'm drinking, smoking, not living right. I get cancer. Well, guess what? Cancer becomes my new addiction, and I have to stop drinking and smoking. So like, what is your current addiction? You have to have one. You're human. you might not know that your human addiction right now is keeping these programs alive through your avoidance, through your lack of awareness, whatever. But you wouldn't be creating the same scenarios over and over again if there wasn't some sort of focal point addiction. There's a part in you that is yesing it. And the part of you that's like, no, we're reparenting. We're going to be different. We're going to affirm. We're going to step in. We're going to practice our authority, right? So that's like using willpower to defeat an addiction. So if you're really going to truly take stock, which I recommend right now, because it's just going to get more intense and more intense and more intense, right? As the world wakes up very quickly, the world is also falling asleep. So it's simultaneously happening where eventually there will be such a grand separation that you won't be able to have a situational ship with this anymore. You will have to choose a relationship. You will have to label. Right now, a lot of us are in a situational ship with this 3D, 5D reality. 5D, oh my God, that's so hard. I got to control every thought I have, right? But I kind of like being mad and I kind of like blaming. And it feels really good when I like speak my truth. You're addicted to that. Okay. And you have to accept the fact that if you're going to live a 5D reality, no one has free will in your reality. So who are you fighting with? Now in 3D, you're so unconscious that you can have the experience that other people are co-creating with you. But in 5D, everybody's in your template and you are literally telepathing them what to say back to you. You have that power, but you can't be in two templates at the same time, because ultimately the program that has been highly addicted all of your life, the I am not program, is going to win. So thought rehab is more about like getting you out of your current addiction, getting you out of the restimulation of manifestation, getting you away from 3D allergies. You guys are not sensitive. You have allergic reactions. That's what a trigger is. Okay. So when you have an allergic reaction, what do? You have to get away from whatever is triggering you. But then what we're taught in 3D is that you just don't eat that anymore. You don't eat gluten anymore. You don't eat dairy anymore, but you are God. So you really want to go through this life without dairy. It is so delicious. Cause I will tell you, I live on it and I used to be allergic to it. Why is that okay that you identify with an allergy? Because an allergy is a wall that you're using as separation. And what probably happened was you were emotionally attacked, judged, hurting, or lost someone when you ate a piece of cheese and your body said, well, it can't be out there because I don't see out there, but what's in here is cheese. And so now, no more cheese. Okay? And so what happens is you still have allergic reactions and now you're allergic to four things. Because your body's like, well, now it's an apple. He just yelled at us when we had an apple. Okay, now it's apples. And your 3D says, oh, it's pesticides and blah, blah, blah. You guys, you're only allergic to physical reality when you are in avoidance, hiding, suffering, lack, loss, guilt, shame, humiliation, because that's what's growing out of your seed. So let's look at the idea of thought rehab. It's obviously I have an hour to kind of like dust this on you, but it is quite intensive. And I don't think that anybody could really get out of this without 30 days. So it's like you see all these like Malibu clinics where the celebrities go away to these beautiful places so they can get out of their environment. They can get out of the people that are enabling, away from enabling them. They can be into a new location around nature with people, places, and things that are designed to help accountability, get to the emotional root issue of why they're addicted, okay, and help them get clean. So you rehabilitating your seed consciousness through the parenting of higher self should be your biggest investment. It should be your full-time job, okay? Now, the living one foot in and one foot out is going to get a lot harder for you, because imagine that consciousness is going to be like you're cheating on your family. Okay, and you're going to try to have two families, it ain't going to work. Okay, I've had a lot of clients that come to me that are top of their spiritual game and they're having an affair, or they're obsessed with married men, right? And you're looking at that and like, how are you living in those both worlds? But if you actually break down what you're doing right now, you're probably living a double life. You're probably having the affirmations and doing the work and stepping into your authority half the day, and half the day you're praying to God. So where are we in that? And if we're only just in a situational ship, why would someone be in a situational ship? I will tell you right now, because I've been in one. I did not value myself enough to ask for what I wanted and needed. And I was hoping that they would fall madly in love with me and decide they wanted me to be their girlfriend. What the? Right? Because we're taught in our a root app. So when you get a smartphone, guys, there's apps that already exist on there. Okay. And if you're not paying attention to what's on there, it's going to be there, which means it's going to be part of your overall vibration. One of the root programs is the old dynamic of male and female. It's like slavery versus there's three women to one man. We're all in competition of each other. We have to be very valuable. We have to be put ourselves out there. We have to be playmates. So that's a root fundamental Adam and Eve program that you literally, you get groomed into by watching the dynamic of your parents. So kind of where you believe your place is as a woman is either what you resisted seeing in mom or what you bought into, right? What you were like, never going to be like her. You probably have rolled in her footsteps somewhere, because resistance creates the persistence. It's like that resistance creates the yes of the universe within you that says, I am, right? Because the only reason that you're resisting something, avoiding something, running away from something, hiding from something, mad at something, is because it's a part of you that you haven't fully accepted, that all that needs to happen is rehabilitation of that aspect. Okay, so it's even more than parenting, right? Because I truly believe that at the root of the war between like custody, okay, and I've gone through this with my son, is that I feel like I'm the omnipresent mother, right, who wants him to feel his feelings and love on him. And dad is the aggressive, like humiliation, militant parent that can't live out his own dreams and so doesn't want his son to, but secretly needs him to be better than him. And it's a whole soap opera, okay? And then my spiritual bypassing of not wanting to look at my son's issues and overgiving and nurturing so that I don't have to feel what he's feeling. And I can also try to heal my inner child by overgiving to him, which never works. You see, so it's bullshit on both ends. But ultimately, if we go, okay, this is it, right? And we literally go and start to, as a scientist, just look at what is, okay? You don't actually need to go into the root to see what's growing, all right? I don't need to look at a tulip outside to see the bulb to make sure it's a tulip. It's going to be a tulip. So what's growing? What's building? What's being created? Okay, what's being destroyed? So we know that a plant will grow the best in its environment. So like I said in several other classes, a lot of times it's not even the seeds issue, it's the soil, right? And so where you are planted could be the trigger, and it's triggering an infection in the seed, and then it's not growing. Or it's growing all like this and it just keeps breaking down, or it has to just grow once and gets pollinated somewhere else because it just needs to run. Fight, flight, freeze, fawn, friend is how we show up to what's growing. What we want to do is take full responsibility to what's growing. And then with that imaginary consciousness, the God consciousness that you've been working so hard, that you spent probably half of your income finding over the years, this higher self version of you, that version of you is going to go inspect the seed and the soil. And that is going to be your rehabilitation coach. Okay. That's going to be the one that's going to hold space in non-judgment, loving, doesn't care about time and space, doesn't care about what's happening, and will literally be there for you while you go through your crackhead shakes of not arguing or reacting or restarting a cycle, okay? So it has to be done from basically the crown and the root. And all the other middleman of what is, needs to go away, just like you would go to Malibu Farms or whatever and get off heroin, because 3D is your heroin. You think it's this person. You think it's this food. You think it's this money. It's the 3D mechanism that your body is so addicted to, because it's created you to be needy of it. So if you've ever seen someone who had a beautiful life and all of a sudden they turn to drugs, look for the influence in their life that pushed them over the edge, right? So they start hanging with the wrong crew, and the emotions that they were repressing in there had a place to grow. And all of a sudden, it's basically we're dealing with a planet of feral children and we're calling ourselves spiritual. But ultimately, when we do get in healthy relationships, we act like we're being attacked when someone is kind. We feel less worthy in loving relationships when we've been basically raised by the wolves. That's a lot of spiritual people. Anybody walking around calling themselves as a black sheep feels like they've been raised by wolves. And that would be me. I fell into that category. And I'm like, nobody understands me. I'm an alien. Like, you see what I'm identifying with there. Okay. So if you've been raised by wolves, right, then you've had to do things to survive. You've had to feel things. You've had to shut down feelings. You have to kind of pick up and leave a lot. You've had to let go of people, places, and things that you've loved to survive. And so now that you are manifesting with that God consciousness within you and you're starting to create some really amazing things, how long is it until the feral child starts to feel like, I don't know how to be in a loving family, even though I've wanted it my whole life. I don't know how to be with money, even though I could probably make it easily. I don't know how to love someone else when they're not perfect, right? Or when they're reflecting back to me things about myself that I can't handle. So we have to start getting real and let go of what's real. If that makes sense. It's like, where the issue is coming from is the root. So let's look at the chakra system. All right. Root is childhood. It's your financial economic situation. It's your community. It's your body. It's your job. Right. So it's like the foundation. So look at the root more of a foundation. Okay. And if you try to grow a house on top of a wonky foundation, you cannot paint the kitchen to fix it. Can't change your hair color. Can't go on a diet. Can't meet a new man. Can't put a new wall up. You have to go down to the foundation and you have to be like, this is on top of an Indian burial ground and it's haunting me, right? Because that's where it is. It's over the graveyard of all your losses, all of your heartbreaks, right? And it's literally your foundation is haunted by loss, lack, failure, right? All of those little stories that when we have those conditions, that's what makes us sell our soul, you guys. We don't sell our soul when we're in abundance and joy. We sell our soul when we're desperate, we're needy, we're hungry, we're lonely. So again, I truly believe I've done way too many past life regressions and QHHT sessions to not believe that we don't bring that certain amount of foundation with us. But here's the thing is God can change a seed, but only God could change a seed. So if you start off as a bad seed or you start off as bad soil, right? It's all changeable, but it cannot be changed in the sacral chakra through what you create. It can't be changed in your coaching program you just made. It cannot be changed in what you wear outside, your demonstration. It cannot be changed in how much you love others. It cannot change through just focal point of truth, I am. It cannot change from what you choose to see only, because ultimately that is all willpower. You're having to use willpower to create. You're having to use willpower to love. You're having to use willpower to see something different. If you would just change it at the root, you would not need willpower over the addiction of what your seed is growing. And so that is where the acceptance piece is. And I truly believe that when you start the acceptance piece, that's when your 40 days and 40 nights start. Because now it's almost like, was Jesus in the desert for 40 days and 40 nights, or was he in the Malibu Farms rehab center? right? Well, like, where was he really? What was he faced against? What happened to him when he was hungry? Right? Someone tried to sneak him some heroin, right? One of his enablers. Who's been your enablers? Who have you created out in the world that has enabled you? Okay. If you notice that you are being ghosted everywhere, you should actually be like, thank you, Jesus. Because what that is saying is you're in rehab, honey, and you don't need another addiction. You don't need another 3 months of love bombing that's going to end in breadcrumbing. And then you're going to go nuts on yourself. And then you're going to create more unworthiness. And you're going to have more ghosts in the tomb under your foundation. Because now you just lost another version of you. See, every time you're in a relationship, you build a consciousness. So when you break up, it's not a breakup, it's a death. It's a death of that potential future, isn't it? You will not grow old with that person. You will not see that person. You go from, this is my person, to strangers. And we live in a very jaded, groomed community where that's kind of normal. We lose people. And then that stacks up. So imagine that that is now haunting your foundation. All right? Because see, a piece of us dies with the relationship because a piece of us was assuming a future that won't happen. Okay? Like, what do you miss the most about people who have crossed over? You can't touch them. You can't see them. They're not going to call you on your birthday. Isn't that the same things you miss in a relationship? Right? And even if you do talk to them, it's not the same consciousness. It's like Pet Cemetery. You get a different version of them and you're like, who are you? Because when they are not your person operating off of a union mindset and they are solo, they are not the same towards you, are they? You're getting a different version of them that is now singular focused and moving on and having different relationships and doesn't actually want you part of their life. And that hurts. Whether you were the leaver or you were the one that got abandoned, it doesn't matter. So now let's look at jobs or businesses or education. Like, how much time did we spend educating ourselves? Did you turn that into a reality? Or is that another loss? Because I know I went to school, I'm not using none of it, right? None of it. I don't necessarily take it as a loss, but some people do. Like, I spent all this time studying this and I'm doing nothing with it. It's dead. All right. Or it's like comatose. It's just hibernating. Okay. And you'll see that when you really start working in your God consciousness, you'll use everything. You'll use everything. Because now it's like I'm pulling from some of those biochem classes. I'm pulling from some of those sociology classes, some of those early childhood development classes. And so technically you use everything when you're in the concept of God consciousness, because there is only immortality. Nothing's dead. Nothing that has ever died from your level of ego consciousness is actually dead. Nothing. That relationship's not dead. Who did you become because of it? What did you learn from it? So it actually gave you more life, but ego consciousness is always going to be narcissistic and it's always going to be looking at what it's lacking and it's your fault or it's their fault. But a lot of these relationships have been what has woken us up. Pain wakes us up, okay? Like if you were a gardener and something kept dying outside, wouldn't you dig up the root to figure out what's going on? Some really great people who have a green thumb can look at the leaves and say, oh, blah, 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 right? It's infected here, it's here, here. But like I said, if it's not the seed, then it's the environment. And so a lot of the times, if you have the God consciousness awareness as a child, which meant you felt more like an adult as a child, you felt more aware in certain situations, you were hypersensitive, you were intuitive, you were empathic, you know, you were the black sheep. Your seed is not the issue. It's the soil. Right. But see, when you grow out of soil for too long, there's something called adaptability. The seed becomes hardened. It becomes thicker skinned because it has to tolerate negative environments. And so when it gets into a blissful environment, it doesn't live as well. It doesn't live in, like, it's used to crisis. It's used to hurricane weather. So now you put it what you say you want, peace, joy, love, ass in the sand, drink in your hand, you would go schizophrenic in that environment if your seed was designed and adapted towards crisis. So what are we actually addicted to? The environment. So thought rehab is about getting so intense on who you are as a seed consciousness and the obsession to grow that which you desire. Not what you can, not what you can settle for. Settling is another addiction. And I will tell you, as a woman, when you have the root consciousness that you are below men, even though you never believe that consciously, and that, you know, a man is, you're lucky to find a man because there's three of you and two of them look better than you, you're going to settle for a guy that, like, you know, damns your character in an argument. And you're going to be like, yeah, I need to work on that. I'm lucky to have you. Right. And vice versa. It's the same. You know, it's like spiritual men are attracting very aggressive, masculine women the same way. So it's all what your reflection is. So if you looked at every single thing in your reality as a reflection of the seed health and the soil health, then you could become your own rehabilitator, which you ultimately, that's why you've been working on your God consciousness for so long. That's why you connected to higher self. That's why you built your relationship with God, or whatever you call that. That's why you understand how the universe works, is so that when it was time for you to rehabilitate your soul, seed, womb of consciousness, that you would have a stable parent, right? Your guardian, the one that's going to hold space unconditionally for you, regardless of how long it takes, or regardless of what is, because you're going to keep growing circumstances for a while that do not resemble that what you're reaffirming and creating. Okay. So with the thought rehab, let's start in the root. Okay. First and foremost, examine your root story, your origin story. Do not accept it as your truth, but examine it. Take stock, not score. I'm not taking score here. Like, this is what I am. This is where my seed is. And this is where it started growing from. So I was a good seed in bad soil, or I was in good soil until my dad died, or until my brother was born. So you figure out. But the thing is almost when you look at yourself as a seed in soil, you take some of the addiction of the story out of it, because your story is actually what you're addicted to. Your story is what your subconscious is running, and your body is addicted to the program. That's why you get so excited to get back into that loop. You get all the hormones. This is it. This time it's going to work. This time the money's coming. This time. And that's not actually true intuition. When it's time your true godly intuition starts to step in, you're going to be terrified and not excited, because you're going to have to do things that you've never done and be someone that you've never been. Ultimately, the program excites you because you get to be you again. The you that you know. The you that you're addicted to. The heroin addict to 3D. You're addicted to 3D. You're also simultaneously allergic. So my grandmother died from Alzheimer's, which to me is like the long goodbye and F you. It's like your unicorn. Your unicorn wings. It's like, there you go. And so she literally made everyone else's life hell because she felt her life was hell. But her favorite food in the world, she had really horrible teeth, and so she had dentures and stuff, but she was gorgeous. And her favorite food was coffee, okay, and ice cream and chocolate. By the time she was 75, she was allergic to coffee, ice cream, and chocolate. That was all she really could eat, because she could melt the chocolate and because she could drink it. I think there was also vodka in there, if I think about it, but I don't think she was allergic to that one, but everything else she became allergic of. So the things that she loved the most, she became allergic of. Can you imagine dying like that? Like, all you have in the world is like your short-term goldfish-like mentality and memories and stuff you can't have, right? And it's just like, it's sad. And we wonder why our parents are acting like sheep. We wonder why, you know, that 95% of the planet is totally fine, jaded, and groomed for what is. You see, so what you're groomed for is what you are addicted to, even if you don't recognize it. You want the narcissistic partner because that's your definition of love. Pain equals love, or absence equals love, or blah, 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 right? So we don't do a thorough examination of the root, then you're actually going to be constantly in judgment of your own addiction. You're going to be constantly shamed, avoidant, simultaneously attached. All right. And so, like, you want to spend time analyzing from that idea of seed and soil versus me and my story. See that when it's me and my story, I'm in the forest and I can't see. There's also way too much hormones and emotions that come up with that story for me to be able to analyze it with non-bias. This is why, even if your life's not perfect, you should absolutely be life coaching. Because here's the thing, is their story isn't, you're not allergic to their story. So you, all the God consciousness that flows through you, you can help them so much better than you can help yourself. And you shouldn't be upset about that. Because you know what happens with me, even this very class? I'm giving it to you because I'm not attached to your version. And so I can watch it again. You see what I mean? It's like, I'm not attached to what you're going through. So I can speak this for you without bringing in any of my heroin addictions to I don't have any justifications. So when I watch it back, you see why coaching is important. 50% of the journey is being a student. 50% of the journey is always going to be a teacher, because you're going to be able to give someone something that you don't believe you can receive. And if you just pay attention to your own session, your own class, or what the heck you're writing, you'll actually get it through default. Right. This is why, even when my life has been in the toilet, I have stayed consistent, because I know that I'm going to tell you something that I need to hear, or I'm going to share something that I needed to let go of. Right. And this is why, when two or more are present, Jesus is there. So this is why this is important for us. Okay. So examining your story is going to get you to not see the whole story, because you're going to have a justification. You're going to have secret addictions. There's a hot mess there. So if you just go, okay, these are my seeds, and this is just my non-biased story, all right? And this is my environment, which is my soil, and this is what I'm growing right now. What am I growing right now? Are there places where you're not growing, where there's nothing coming up above the surface? Everything is bubbling up under the surface, okay? Analyze that. Don't judge it. Just what is? Acceptance, okay? It's first analyze. And then accept, okay, this is it. This is what we have to work with. This is why we always say, take stock, not score. Take stock is like, what do we have to work with? What are the cards we have right now? Because you are, with your imagination, you become a magician. So all of this is changeable through imagination, but we first have to analyze what it is, okay? We don't need to know what it means to us, or we don't need to flatline into despair yet, okay? This is me going, I need help. Can someone please check me into the hospital? That's acceptance. I can't take care of me right now. That's acceptance. Because here's the thing. Your ego does not want to surrender parenting of you. So the ego part of you will never ask for help. I got this. I can do this on my own. I don't need to go to rehab. I've got this. They lose their house. They lose their kids. I got this. I just need to let go of everything for a while, you know, like, no, you don't got this, because the narcissistic ego has been a consciousness. So here's the thing. If you are in a relationship with someone and you start being intimate, you form a consciousness, your DNA, their DNA, it's a separate consciousness. That's why when you're together, people identify you as the couple and what you're co-creating. So aren't you in a co-creation with 3D? So didn't you form a consciousness out of it? That's your ego. Okay. That's the child of your seed and your soil mixed together. And that's your story. So no matter how bad your kid is or your life is, you love it. So your ego consciousness will never put you through rehab. Ever. Ever. You go on a mind diet, you get in a situational ship with clean living and secret not clean living, and you'll say, Jess, it's not manifesting. my special person is not changing their mind about me. Like, I keep getting abused. I keep getting hurt. I keep the bottom keeps dropping out. My body won't heal. You're in a situational ship. You got to go to rehab. You got to go cold turkey. So how do we go cold turkey in the environment? Because this is like metaphysical. Like, me going to rehab isn't a possibility with my lifestyle, right? It's not like I can go to my partner and be like, tell him this story, have him fully accept and understand, and then be like, and I'm leaving for 30 days. Now, some of you could, and some of you try to do that, and you go do ayahuasca, and you go to the mountains of Peru, and you meditate with amazing people, but that's not your rehab. That's you going looking for something to rehab you. This is why a lot of the times you come back ayahuasca damaged, and then I've got to fix that mental illness because you opened the gates of hell. And you have unworthiness, which means you didn't walk all the way through it. So now we've got to create the worthiness with the ayahuasca wounding or whatever you did with the shaman that said he was legit. Okay, so this is why when you start to go through rehab, your God consciousness is your rehab. And if you need someone like a mentor or someone, a teacher or reflection, you better find the reflection of your God consciousness who's going to be brutally honest with you and hold you accountable to that which you say you are. Otherwise, the coach becomes an enabler. Well, let's look over here in your past life. No, let's look at your bills, your body, right? Your relationship conflicts. Who are you not talking to in your family? Why haven't you created a different version of them so you can have a better playground? Don't you secretly want your parents? Even if they were horrible, even if they've crossed over, don't you want to die with good memories of that? Because you could create that. Remember, imagination, I am magician. You can't use your magic if you're not in acceptance of what is, because you're trying to change circumstances and events with your magic and it doesn't work. It has to change in the root. So now let's look at what happens with the root, the second chakra, creation. Okay, so creation is what soil and seed, masculine, feminine, do together to birth a bloom. So what have you created? It feels like other people are creating for you, but even if you're getting a paycheck or help by someone, that's you. Good job. Okay, so don't be in judgment if someone's paying your bills right now. Be like, good job. Okay, honor it. Okay, because again, you're creating it, but you're also creating the guilt, shame that you can't do it for yourself. And that's why you're not enjoying it. All right, when you can be responsible for every single thing right now, okay, even the ghosts that are haunting your foundation, like that's my loss. That's my heartbreak. Okay. That's my failures. That's the Indian burial ground, guys. And then the foundation that I put on top of that, that I grew my childhood out of, and the childhood grew the prairie, you know? So it's like, you're not just dealing with one bloom at this point. You're dealing with a entire like field of whatever it is. And you look at these beautiful things you've grown, but you also see the weeds, right? And the dysfunction and the weather and all that stuff. That's your reality. So what are you creating now? And what have you created? It's just acceptance. So if I was going to go to rehab and I'm going to go sit with someone who is literally a good rehab specialist, okay, they aren't going to be looking at the addiction. They're going to be looking at why. They're going to be looking at where did that need come from? And what am I getting from that addiction that I believe that I cannot live without? So they won't even care that it's heroin. They won't care that you're 600 pounds. They don't care that you're addicted to porn. They care why, how, when. And this is where you need to examine. And if you're so fixated on the judgment of what you're doing or what you've done, you'll never actually become a loving parent guardian to yourself to get past the story and go into the why. See, like the subconscious is the why, right? The unconscious is the what. what happened to me in the womb, and my why is what grew out of it. Okay, that's why I have to swaddle myself at night or something. Who knows? Like, that's your why. That's why you need to sleep with a weighted blanket, because you were born too early through C-section. You didn't get to go through the canal, so now you need to go. Or the autism kicked in when, you know, whatever, and you need focused, organized energies. Who cares? It just is why. That's your why. Okay, you are that way, and your life is that way. Okay, take stock, right? See, when you say, what would I choose to create without changing the root? Now you've created desire. Because what I want to create and what I am are two different things. So what happens is, if we could change the root, we actually don't have to create out of desire. We just create from what it is. I am abundant. I am free. I am loving. I am loved. Instead of, I want to create love. I want to create happiness. I want to create money. I want to create this. I want to. So what happens is, the discord is between the subconscious and the unconscious. But if you don't know the unconscious is, you're screwed. Because if you're just working on your subconscious programs, that's like me going outside and plucking flowers and weeds every day with affirmations. You want to change the hard drive, right? The software is easy to change. But if I go up against an unconscious program about myself with only affirmations, but yet I'm still creating BS, who's going to win? Mental warfare, psychosis, self-abandonment, rejection, just chaos. And so when I'm telling you guys to stand in your authority, not in your history, what I mean by that is, your authority is your God consciousness of what I choose to be. No score, no stock. You can literally create from nothing. Particles, ideas. That doesn't seem realistic when you're in an allergy of 3D. Because you're surviving here, and you're like, what? Why am I creating from scratch? Okay, so now let's look. What am I creating? That's your sacral. And what are people creating at me? That's the mirror reflection. So it's not just what you're creating. It's what people are creating back at you. And this is where you're like, well, I can't find anybody to work with. Me and my partner aren't seeing eye to eye. My kids are being jerks. Because this is your co-creational field. This is your reflection of what you're creating, is what's coming back at you based on what's unconscious. Now, if we're not usually conscious of this, then we're reacting, which is the next chakra demonstration. That is the solar plexus, yellow. Like, this is where light gets shined on your programs, your solar plexus, where you demonstrate your root, where you demonstrate the creativity that's coming from your root, where other people are demonstrating towards you what's growing out of your root. Now let's play non-duality here and flip that word. Demonstrate, straight demon. Okay? If people are coming at you straight demon right now, that's your opposition of your own demonstration. What you want versus what you are. Now, you are not what's coming at you, but you are a belief that has become live. Look at that word, belief, be live. Be alive, belief. So if you believe secretly that, and I had this when I just found it, and I was like, curse you. It was literally, when I am at the top of my game, I'm humiliated. When I rise up, I'm attacked. When I speak my truth, I'm in trouble. And I found that one before, but I've never rehabbed it. Like, totally rehabilitated that, because I don't want that to be true. But it's literally a story that happened over and over again in childhood. And I resisted it and I rejected it. And then fundamentally, I became it. And then I attracted that to happen every single time of me through creation of my sacral. And then I would demonstrate the reaction of that. And I would run away. No fair. You got to be nice to me. This is where I practice my worth. Right? And I deserve better. So this is where everything comes to light in your demonstration. So you don't really... A lot of us are aware until the demonstration starts. And so if you look up the word doubt in the dictionary, the root, right, is like demon or vice versa. It's like doubt and demon are the same word. Demonstrate. This is where you really notice those five D's, right? The divergence, the doubt, the discouraged, the defeat. That's when you're going to start seeing a lot of that is in that solar plexus where the basically the bud becomes a bloom. So blooming is solar plexus. It's like the little bead is now in the sun or in the light, and that's your solar plexus. What's demonstrating to you and what you're demonstrating out of you. And so this is why we're trying to work on our reactions. Okay, this is where most of us become conscious. All right, now if you don't become conscious in this, the next one's absolutely going to smack you into your awareness here. Because the next one is, how do I feel about what's being demonstrated? How do I feel about what is being demonstrated back to me? This is where it starts to hurt. Because see, down here, I'm angry. I'm reacting. I'm protective. Ow, oh my God, what's happening? When it gets to here, it's like, that hurts me. I don't like that. This is why when you get in an argument with someone and you run on each other and you attack each other or you defend yourself or you shut down, it is when you get back to your own energy and you sit with how it actually made you feel, you and how it might have felt for them. This is where the neutrality is. And this is where you can begin to understand through all these labors what is happening based on how you feel about it. But again, if you got a bunch of ghosts sitting in your basement, under your foundation, honestly, of heartbreak and despair and rejection and abandonment and abuse, okay, then that's going to be where more walls are built. I don't like how this feels. And you're going to fight, flight, freeze, fawn, or friend it. Okay, because you got to survive your addiction to 3D, right? So this is where I feel bad. And so now I want to talk about it. I want to say something, right? Or it's not safe for me to talk. I need to shut it down, seal the pipe off. Now my teeth hurt. I got raging toothaches and lymphatic stuff happening, and my ears hurt. They're ringing like crazy, right? I feel a block when I try to speak. Okay. And then, of course, now what do I see? Because you're going to filter through your programs. You're only going to see what you truly believe at the root point of who you are. So literally the solution could be right in front of you and you wouldn't see it. Or you wouldn't have the idea of how to get it. It could be literally right there because all worlds exist simultaneously. So the world that you actually desire to be is sitting right there, but you can't see it. Which means when they say everything you want is already yours, it's just being able to be seen, heard, and felt through the vibrational reality that is the choice of your root that you're not living. So you only get to see the hell you're creating from your own demonstration. Demonstration. Okay. So if you don't like that, right, then what's going to happen when you get into the crown of I am? Well, I must not be good enough. I must not be good enough because what I'm seeing, what I'm feeling, what I'm thinking, right? Well, now I know that this is, I'm just not worthy. And then that becomes your why. And now men and women deal with why very differently. Okay, so a woman is a curious being of taking information and making it into all more things. So I've noticed that my women clients get so much more lost in their why, and men get a lot more lost in their what. Okay, because fundamentally the why is like the currency, the energy of moving. And so this is why, like, when a partner demonstrates like that they don't want you anymore, you're not going to be satisfied with that. You're going to go have to figure out why. I'm going to go stalk all their exes and see if it was maybe because I wasn't pretty enough or I don't have enough money, or I'm going to go figure out why he doesn't want me. Okay, so it's like now what we're doing is we're making the whole thing alive. And then again, you might run away with your own demonstration or yell or shit. You're going to fight, flight, friend, fawn, friend it. So if you're a fawn, you're going to stay miserable in that situation and you're going to blame it all on yourself. If you friend it, you basically are trying to get so close to it that it can't hurt you. So it becomes like an enabler, right? You got to do exactly what they want Because if you show up not as a people pleaser anymore, they're going to start turning on you. So you've got to figure out how to friend that. All right. All of a sudden, I'm not going to want to be a friend, a people pleaser anymore. And they're like, oh, really? Now you get to see what's in that mind demonstration. And you're like, oh, I don't like that. I better find a way to be friends with them, or heal them, or fix them, or save them, or nurture them. All right. And if you're a freeze, well, that's when your body just starts shutting down or getting bigger. Right. Or all kinds of stuff start breaking out because you're not actually frozen. You're just inhaling everything. And it's becoming the arguments that you won't have out loud become arguments with your liver or your sciatic or whatever, because you're still having the arguments, just not out loud. All right. So now look at the fight. That's your reaction. That's me taking my power back and standing as a strong woman. Okay. That's fight. Or, you know, you get into a custody battle, or you go do what you need. This is where the fight happens. We're like custody battle over the feral child. Okay, so who are you fighting with? What are you fighting with? What are you fighting against? Where's your injustice wounds? Where's your wrath? Okay. And then ultimately the fight, flight, freeze, fawn, and friend is like, that's how you're showing up to the addictions that you are creating from the soil and root bound. That's like the consciousness that grows 3D. So this is why circumstances do not matter. And the more energy we give to circumstances, that's the addiction. And that's why we have to pull out of 3D altogether and re-examine, okay? And go through rehabilitation of our own mind, our own garden, our own reality, our own desires, right? Anything that you desire that you don't have, you're not a vibrational match to. That sucks to hear, but it doesn't mean that you couldn't easily change that, because the God consciousness is the imagination. The imagination is the magician, but it has to come from an honest, hard look at what you're growing out of you. And you'll never do it half-ass. This is why we stay on the spiritual journey for 25 years and spend thousands of dollars and have a toolbox that is bigger than most doctors and scientists and astronauts, and yet we still can't rub two nickels together or find a loving partner, right? It's like, what? It's because we're using that spiritual journey as the new addiction, because the dopamine and the community and the awareness and the feel is what you prefer. But to me, wouldn't you rather have that in your reality, that you in your garden, instead of having to go retreat or go to a mountain in Peru to find yourself? Because ultimately, whatever you're running from, you're running into. Feel that. Whatever you're running from, you're running into. So at some point, we have to stand in our creation, acknowledge it, accept it, and rehabilitate it. Once it gets to the rehabilitation state, right, that surrender, now we can become a magician. So in like spirituality, or like the biblical idea of it, it would be redemption, which is a change of mind after full acceptance, which means you first have to accept that this is you. Every single person in your reality is you reflected back. So Neville Goddard says, everything is us pushed out. Well, look at a seed. Everything grows from you. So same concept. Everything is growing out of you. And if you believe that you're growing things that can hurt you, or things that have their own free will, you're not looking at it through your God consciousness yet, because you're not competing with other flowers out there. There's no other flowers. It's all you. There's no other weeds. It's all you. There's no storms. It's all you. And then the analogy of a seed and a bloom, right? The idea of weather is emotion. What are you doing with it? Are you suffocating it? Are you utilizing it? Are you utilizing anger to get more acceptance of yourself? Or are you using anger to suppress yourself? Because you can use every single emotion to bring more clarity here. You can use grief to go clear your ghosts out of your house. You can use grief to flush them out. That's what great sorrow of baptism is. You can actually grieve where you've never allowed yourself to grieve, if that needs to happen. In order for a parent to truly rehabilitate a child, they've got to go back into the trauma and reenact that with a loving outcome. Okay. You're not just going to create a whole new reality outside of you with a seed that feels unworthy and like a failure. Because ultimately, within 3 to 6 months, you'll start to feel the failure. You'll start to feel the avoidant. You'll start to feel the rejection and abandonment coming through again. And you'll be like, man. And then you get more aware of it. And you're like, oh my gosh, here, this pattern is so in my face. And I've done this 15, 20 times. And I get excited to do it every time. Because that's the addiction. All right. So when we are rehabilitating, it's first and foremost examine what is. You don't need to go underground and look at the seed. You just look at the circumstances. The circumstances are the combination of the seed health and the soil health. And is it in unity of the same consciousness? Or is this soil literally starving the seed? Okay, because it's the 3D is designed to starve you into death. Okay, or feed you to death. That's victim perpetrator. And like, there was this gal on TikTok the other day, and I was just like grazing, and she was one of those ones who was a victim of a feeder. And that means that her perpetrator, his secret fetish was to feed her to death. And she was about 600 pounds. And she said she had no idea what was happening because she'd never felt loved like that. She'd never felt cared for like that. All her bills were being paid. He just kept bringing her food. She never felt so in love. And then she started realizing that after like 400 or 500 pounds, she's like, I don't feel good. And his real colors came out, and he told her what his intentions were. This is like any other addiction we're dealing with here, right? At the beginning, it feels like what you've always needed. So in 3D, you're always going to manifest what you've always wanted, but it's going to be the vibration of the root, which means if the vibration of the root is abandonment rejection, 3 to 6 months, 3 to 6 years, you're going to start feeling that again, and you're going to be very confused. And so sometimes we don't know until the post-manifestational awareness. Don't judge yourself. The better at this you get, the better you will get at anticipating. And if you do thought rehab properly, then you won't have to manifest and then realize. You won't have to demonstrate to wake up. You won't have to react to know. You'll be like, this is the root. This is what I creatively grow. And this is what's growing towards me in the mirror. And then this is what I'm demonstrating. And this is what's demonstrating back. This is how I feel about it. This is what I think about it and know about it. This is what I see about it and hear about it. And this is what I am. All right. So look at the chakras as the growth process. Okay. You cannot affirm I am God and I am rich with a dusty, moldy root, because it's going to be more torture for you. Haven't we been tortured enough? Right? Like, we've been tortured enough to now start standing in our authority at the crown chakra when the mess is in the root. Right? So what it is a rehabilitation. So after we do the awareness and the observation and the acceptance, okay, once the acceptance is there, this is where the forgiveness work works. And it's not, I forgive you and I forgive me and God, please forgive me. I believe that it's actually kind of a walk you have for a while. This is why I think that a real deep core wound could take about 30 days, but it's probably connected to so many things that would change like that in your life. So it would be worth it. The forgiveness is showing up differently. It's not just doing forgiveness work at night. It's like, how could you live in a state of forgiveness for a while? Really, like, analyze what true forgiveness is. If you've ever asked for an apology from someone, okay, and they want to forgive you, but they're hurt, okay? They really do want to forgive you, but they're hurt. What do they want to know? Okay, true forgiveness is a change of behavior. At the ego level, do you know what forgiveness is at an ego level? You're going to resonate with this. At an ego level, forgiveness is accepted at remorse. How many times have you wanted your people who hurt you to feel remorse for you? So your ego parent wants remorse. It wants you to pay and feel what it feels. So if that's where your forgiveness work is, you go into guilt and shame for yourself, and you're feeding the ego consciousness. But if you go, okay, well, true forgiveness is a change of behavior. where am I demonstrating this root program, and where can I start pausing? Where can I clean out? Where can I say no, thank you? Where can I work on my nervous system so I'm not in a constant state of like fight, flight, freeze, fawn, friend? You know, where can I regulate? What can I remove? Because you got to get rid of the allergy, right? If you've got a 3D allergy, you've got a 3D allergy. I think every single one of the spiritual beings out here trying to get our soul back has an allergy to 3D because we've been personally attacked by it and shamed and guilted. And now the body's like, I don't want to be here. I don't want to be here. Go back to meditation. Go get some more mushrooms. Like, let's go do something else except be here. Let's go take another class. Let's go get another hit off the spiritual crack pipe. And ultimately, it's like your spiritual class is not going to be at the dinner table. You got to embody that. So what I notice is that we get the hit off of desire or want or communion, but then we don't actually embody it. So we don't change it. Embodiment is changing the root. That's what embodiment means. All right. So, and what I've seen through doing so much PTS therapy with our veterans and children who have been abused is that the fastest way to change it is to go back into it and accept it, rehabilitate it, do the forgiveness work, which is a change of behavior. The change of behavior is going to show up in your demonstration. It's going to show up in your inspirations. It's going to show up in your motivation. Okay. And it's not going to feel like a dopamine hit of like, yeah, this is it. It's going to be like, I'm going to have to be courageous now. I'm going to have to show up differently. I'm going to have to stop doing that. So most of us are not getting past the forgiveness piece because we're not demonstrating the change. Best forgiveness is a change of behavior. Now, if you asked your child for forgiveness every day, yet you kept hurting them, what would they feel towards you? They wouldn't trust you. So if you have trust issues with other people or yourself, that's why. You're not loyal to your own forgiveness. You're feeling guilt and shame and true remorse in the moment, but you're not actually changing the behavior that hurt you. Now, if you stay with that behavior again, you become the abuser, right? And now you must be self-abusing because you don't feel worthy, which is in the root, okay? So once we do the forgiveness work, what's next? Change of behavior, change of direction, decide, pick a side, and literally flow all of your consciousness into new root programming. New root programming. Not I am rich, like I am worthy of all abundance. Like you want to actually create more fundamental roots. And we're going to work on that in classes coming up, is what would be really good root affirmations that we could walk and talk in, feel in, process in, share as, so we can use all the chakras to become it. Like you're embodying the practice of the affirmation versus just thinking it with willpower, you know, and then you get your mind go talk you and have to. And again, like that's a process. So that's to me where the authority really starts to kick in. It's like creating the dominance over that feral child, but not in a duress or hurtful way. So to me, dominance and submission in 3D is based in pain. Okay, like using the dominatrix and they're whipping people and the little guy with a ball in his mouth, like, so you know, like that's 3D dominance and submission, like, you know, kind of glorified. But when we look at dominance and submission of 3D in our realities, is you don't go to work, you lose your house. So who's the dominant? Okay. You know, your husband pays the bills. So who do you have to secretly submit to? Whose ego in the house? Okay. So looking at dominance and submission in 3D is the slavery master program. Dominance and submission in 5D is loving parent that knows more than you do, and you being the disciple or the receiver. So like in a healthy masculine and feminine relationship, right, is like the man's species was designed to lead, build, provide, protect, fix, right? He's the container. The woman's job is to fill the space with beauty, love, peace, harmony, nurturing, nature. Together, that is the perfect union. Okay. And in our society, women can't do that safely a lot of the times, and men don't provide that. They want us to provide that, but they're not willing to necessarily be the safe space for us to be free to fill that space. Okay. And so that in our 3D environment, one of the fundamental things that keeps the slavery program going is the imbalance of the masculine feminine role. And guess what? You have two hemispheres of your brain. One's masculine, one's feminine. So you actually are doing this to yourself. So if you look at the issues that you're having right now in your relationship with your person, special person, and if you're not with them right now, look at the last one. What was the current issue? That's the current issue you're having with your own masculine or your own feminine energy. What was I not getting? What was not fair? How was I abused? That is what's happening in your root chakra with you, king and queen. And then you'll manifest it in masculine energy outside of you or feminine energy outside of you. So that's to be examined. Examination of your story from a seed soil place is going to be your most non-dualistic approach. Because if you try to examine it from your emotional state, you're going to get triggered by it. And you need to get away from the allergy. So two pieces of homework. Really, we want to start embodying this. So how you could embody this, and so masculine is very visual and it needs to kind of like see this. So one of the ways that the feminine energy can fill the space that you can actually see from your masculine energy is to draw a diagram, get a poster board, and actually create the dirt and the seed, okay, and leave it empty and create kind of your desire. Like, what are you putting in the seed? You could even do it side by side. What's in there right now? Doubt, discouragement, weight issues, financial issues, debt, you know, uncertainty, shame, fill it. So you can see it. And then show what's growing out. Do like a seed, like a bloom of debt. Grow a bloom of, you know, tumor that you found on the back of your leg. Whatever. See it. Because one of the things about ego is the art of diversion. If you've ever gotten trapped with a narcissistic relationship for a while, you don't see who they truly were until way later. Because it's such an emotional seduction that you can't really know what's happening because you're surviving it. So you adapt to it, you friend it, and you fawn it to save yourself. And then when you get on the other side of it, or here's the best thing, like someone will get me as a new coach and they'll start telling me their story of their partner. And I'm like, oh my gosh, they can hear themselves tell me how bad it is. And then they realize how bad it is. But see, when they're living it and they're not having to tell, even though I'm completely non-judgmental and totally get it, narcissists and empaths, that's the master slave program. So, but they tell me and they're like immediate shame and awareness because they spoke the truth of it. But when you're living it, it doesn't seem that bad. There's hope, right? There's, well, he was really great last week. If we could just get him like that every time. And most of the time they hire me is to fix him. You know what I mean? Because they don't think that their root is the problem at all. They're like, how do I manifest him changing? Okay. So you're the slave and he's the master, basically. So we got to change that program in the root. That's the indoctrination. That's the app you had downloaded on your phone. You got to change that one immediately. Okay. So that would be a fun diagram. And when I say fun, it's like awareness, like not going to be fun when you're actually drawing what is and what you've grown out of, like what you've grown through you right now. And also grow the beautiful things that you're growing. Grow where you live if you love it. Grow this partner that you have that you love, but also grow the debt so you can see it all. This is to bring awareness. This is not about having remorse for what you created and cry for 2 weeks. This is about how do I change this behavior? Because that's the best forgiveness. So then on the other side, maybe you could draw the dirt and make it yummy. Make it like vibrant and moisturized and fluid. And then draw your root. And what do you prefer your fundamental building blocks, your foundation of this home to be? What are your fundamental building blocks? Do you want to be a fundamental survivor? Or do you want to be courageous in your thriving? Like, start with joy. Okay. There's been so many times where I've created such a big life outside of me that was so joyful, but I couldn't feel it. I'm literally looking at my children and I'm like, I can't feel this joy. I cannot feel the happiness. I can't feel the satisfaction of what I've created, because what I've created was that drive, masculine drive in there to build something, but I couldn't actually experience it. I know women are hearing me when I say that, maybe some of the men too. But if you have a beautiful life and you can't feel that, right? There's a reason why. Got to change your route. So what do you want at your fundamental building block? Like joy, right? Connection, union, community. That's got to start in the root. And then you will create that and it will reflect back to you through creation out. And then you'll have that. But we cannot go be creators of what we desire. We can only be creators of what we are. So when you create a reality, you are creating from the root, bottom line. Start in the foundation. Even if it takes you a month, you might save 10 years off your journey here and probably hundreds of thousands of dollars, because you're going to keep searching for this in the demonstration, which is where we get lost in the spiritual part of it or the psychic part of it. And if you look at the bottom three chakras, they're considered hell until you, through imagination of your own magician, basically redesign your route and embody it, which means grow from that. Okay? So we're going to work more on how. Secondary thing you can do, guys, that I thought might be fun, especially if you don't have a green thumb, is go get a seed and plant it in a clear cup so you can actually see what you are doing. And then you have to water it and tend to it. You can't overwater it, can't over-nurture it, you can't under-nurture it. That would be a good experiment for us for thought rehab, because basically what grows out of it is going to be the health and conditions and the support and parenting of the seed when it is germination and blooming. So the parent that you are is either growing or you're not growing, or you're growing in a small container, because like that's my situation with my houseplants right now. I need to replant them and put them in bigger pots because they will only grow in the container that they are in. Or be like me in physical reality and just feel like you outgrew the container and then you just uproot and go somewhere else. That's been my story. I'm like, I'm too tight for this. I got to go somewhere else. I've grown past this person. I'm grown past this. And then I start over again. Okay. When all I needed to do was have a loving parent repot me in a bigger space. But see, big fish, little pond syndrome, guys. You have to understand that ego has that program. I want to be a big fish in a little pond, even though I say this pond is too small, because I don't really want to be seen in her too big. Okay. I have people message me all the time. Why are you not more famous? Why do you not have more followers? Well, look at my houseplants. Okay. Like, obviously that's where my root is. Like, be as big as you can in the smallest pot, because that's where you're safe. Okay. So that's my story. So maybe do those two science experiments this week, right? Observe, accept, forgive, practice. Right? Practice, prepare, play. Practice, prepare, play. Posture. Who are you in this forgiving space? What does this change behavior look like? What are you demonstrating? And what are you being, straight demon? All right? Like, look at everything in non-dualistic terms. Whatever is not happening, there's an opposition somewhere that you could imagine as if, and live in that space. Because it's almost like when Neville says, live in the wish fulfilled, what he's saying is put different stuff in the root that already is. So joy can grow from the root. You're not searching for the joy in the bloom. You are the joy. You are the connection. You are the community. You are the partnership. You are the soulmate. You are the money. So put it in the root. And then do everything that you would have to do as a plant parent to make sure that that seed blooms. And what I've noticed when I've done this experiment in quantum fitness a lot is we tend to overwater or forget to water. So looking at that as trying to affirm, like, I am, that's overwatering. And then we forget and we get triggered for 2 weeks and we forget to water it. And it's like, because yeah. Plants are not like pets or kids. They won't ask. So your subconscious won't ask to change. My child will be like, please feed me. And I'll be like, oh, shoot, I forgot about you. You know, my plant will not unless I observe it. It's not going to ask me for help. And either is your subconscious mind. It's just going to do what it can do where it is with what it has. Dr. Emoto's work. What do you say about yourself is the health and vitality. You are 70% water. Go look at some of his videos about what thought does to water. And then you're basically a houseplant. Okay. All right. So that's my class for today. Hope that helped. Triggered the crap out of me, obviously, when I started to become aware of it. But it's also so exciting because this isn't about hope. Hope is not changing the root and hoping circumstances change, right? This is more of embodiment work that if you do the fundamental work now and you build the foundation with your masculine feminine energy, you won't have to keep regrowing it. Because like once you actually do this, you guys, have you noticed it set it and forget it? If you really do the work as a gardener, the way it should be doing, you'll have seasonal blooms, you'll have annuals, that's what your subconscious is doing. That's why certain PTSD is seasonal. That's why certain trauma is like around your birthday. It's because it's a seasonal seed that's growing. Okay. So if you looked at yourself as that, all you would have to do is go change that fundamental root and then let the seasons and annuals, it's a set it and forget it. And that is one thing that I know for certain because I did that with my physical body. I went to the root, I changed it, and now I don't have to monitor my weight. I don't have to exercise. I don't have to micromanage like food. I don't have fiber. I don't have autoimmune disease anymore. I'm not overweight anymore. My cellular age has changed. You know, I don't have allergies to gluten and dairy anymore because I actually like focused on that first. And so now I have proof that this works. Because I set it and forget it. Now, no matter what stress is happening around it, my body uses stress energy differently. It uses food differently. And so if we can do that, we can do this with anything. We can do this with relationships, which means we'll just keep getting better and better because the plants get stronger and stronger once they adapt to their new realities and they learn how to grow in joy. They learn how to grow in love. But most of the reasons we still have conflicts in our relationship is because we're addicted to the conflict. Okay, because that's what we know. That's what's growing out of us. Okay, have fun with those two science experiments. And I'd love to hear, or in our private group, at least like on Messenger, maybe share some of your pictures of the plus side. You don't have to show the current side. That's between me, myself, and I, but like your good side, because this is a fun demo. It's kind of like a vision board for your God consciousness and what you're planting right now. Okay. And like, don't look at circumstances because you're not going to get the harvest right when you plant. You're going to have to posture, practice, prepare, play, practice, prepare, play, as is, already is, create, demonstrate, feel, think, speak, see, know. That's going to be your practice to embody this and catch yourself before you wreck yourself. Otherwise, get yourself a mentor or find one of our fellowship classes. Okay. Because this is very, very difficult to do without some sort of rehabilitation accountability, especially when you've been trying to do this, manifest something for a long time. If there is something that you've been manifesting that you still don't have, you got an addiction somewhere to not having it. And you're going to have to come clean about that. Okay. All right, guys. Thank you so much for your time. And I will see some of you in the fellowship later. Bye.